can do.
Hey, good morning. How you doing? We all right? Good to see you all. Why don't you stand to your feet? For those of you that are joining us online this morning, hey, we love you. And we're so excited that you can join us in this service today. But hey, I don't know about you, but I've come to praise God this morning. I've come to lift up His name. So I'm just going to pray for us right now, and then we're just going to get into praise and worship this morning. But Father, we just come before you. This morning, we just acknowledge that your presence is here. Your word says, Father, when two or more are gathered together, you are right in the midst. And so, Lord, we thank you for that promise of the scriptures that you are here with us today. And God, we just think of every person that isn't able to gather in the room today, but maybe joining online at home. Father, I pray that there would be such unity. Father, that your spirit would move in every heart and every space and every home this morning. We exalt you. We lift you up. We're here to praise your name in Jesus' mighty name. And God's people said this morning, amen. Amen. Come on, let's praise together this morning.
Song is in D, yes.
I don't even know what I'm doing right now. This is, we have a guest today, Zach. This has never happened before. This is brand new. Praise God. What are we doing? Does this sound like D to you?
Here we go.
Woo! Now you have to clap extra loud.
Holy wrong waking up our heart.
stop our praise, fears falling, chains breaking, nothing's gonna stop, nothing's gonna stop our praise.
Father, we bring our hearts before you this morning. We acknowledge you. We exalt you. We worship you. God, our eyes are fixed on you this morning. Oh, we love you, Jesus. There's no one like you, Jesus. Nor the place we'd rather be. In your presence.
knowing you would wear the crown of shame. Only love could wear that kind of pain. Worthy is Lamb, worthy is Lamb. And only you could overcome the grave. Knowing
Just lift our hands to heaven right now, just in prayer to the Lord. Father, we just thank you so much that you are here with us. What an amazing thought that you're not far away or distant, emotionally cold towards us, but you love us with every fiber of your being. You so love the world that you sent your one and only Son. Father, we just praise you right now. I just thank you for every person gathering across in the body of Christ this morning, whether they're gathering in homes, gathering in buildings, or watching online. Father, wherever your people are, I just pray that for a special sense of the presence of God right now in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Fall afresh, empower us. I just thank you, Father, that you are in charge of the world. You're the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You have stepped down and crushed the enemy under your feet. And so, Lord, we just praise you right now. That, Father, there has been a revolution at the cross. You said, it is finished. You are the King of the whole world. You defeated all the principalities and powers. And, Father, it may not look like it fully yet, but one day you shall return with a flaming sword to destroy your enemies and uphold the people of God in righteousness, Father, and your kingdom shall be established forever. So we just praise you right now and give you all the glory and the honor and the praise. You are worthy. We serve a God who is more than able to do more than we could ask, think, or imagine. And so we give you all the praise in Jesus' name. God's people said, amen, amen. Great to be in church this morning. Welcome to all of you, and welcome if you're watching online. I'm so glad, you know, obviously we're in some restrictions right now in the state, and that's a little bit frustrating and hard to deal with, but aren't we still thankful that we can meet together? And I'm really glad that we're two churches in the local area, because, or two campuses, one church rather, there's enough spread for everybody to be able to attend church, and so I'm really glad for that. If you're watching online, bless you as well. We just pray God's blessing over you guys. But it's great to see you here this morning. And hey, we've had some good news. Talis and Emma got engaged over the weekend. So we're happy for those guys. Caitlin and Joel are about to get married. Ben and Belle are about to get married. Love. Love is in the air. And that's good. I think you've got to concentrate on the good things in life, hey? I love it. I love it. I love it. Love, love. So good. Well, it's good to see you. You can take your seats, everybody. Wonderful to see you all. I pray you've been blessed this week. I know some people have just taken advantage of the borders opening, have already gone traveling. We've got a special guest here with us this morning, two guests. We've got Zach here with us this morning. Pastor Zach, will we just give Pastor Zach a hand? He's with Alpha Australia. And we just love Alpha here. It's actually Mission Sunday. And so as part of Mission Sunday, every first Sunday of the month, we focus in on our missions. And we love running Alpha in the church because we love preaching the gospel. And so excited to hear from Pastor Zach this morning. We've also got Bernie. Bernie's here with us this morning. Would we give Bernie a hand? Bernie's in charge of Prison Alpha across our state. And just an awesome man of God. Love his passion. Bernie, so good to have you here with us as well. So thanks for visiting, guys, this morning. We're going to hear from Zach a little bit later. So excited about that. But it's great to be here this morning and hope you're doing really, really well. We've had a great week and just believing for a great week to come. Now, just to let you know, obviously with the ticketing process, it's a little bit frustrating. I know that it's hard. It's like, whoa, why do we have to ticket in church? Well, we just have to abide by the restrictions that are put in place right now. We want to do the right thing that the government is asking us to do. We're hoping that it won't be long, but while it's in place, we want to make sure everybody's safe and doing the right thing. So ticketing will be in place for the next few weeks until level two is restricted. Level two restrictions are released. And so until that time, we're still going to be ticketing. So please watch out for your emails. It's going to be on social media. Make sure you book a ticket as early as possible. And if you don't get here at Swan, I really want to encourage you. Hey, it's an awesome opportunity to go and visit our Malaga campus if you haven't had a chance to do that yet. And Jake and Tegan and the team over there would love to host you. And there's just an opportunity for all our people to be able to access church, which I love. So I want to encourage you to do that. Hey, we just before the kids go out to DBK, we're going to take up our tithes and offerings. And so if you need a debit card slip to assist you with your giving, you can put your hand in the air. Hosts can get that to you. Thank you, hosts. We also have online giving and or internet banking or whatever you want to do. I just want to say thank you so much to those of you who are practicing the biblical principle of the tithe, 10%, your first 10% that actually goes back to the Lord. And Mel and I have been practicing this principle from the start of our Christian life. And man, we just know that we can't outgive God. Who knows that? That as you practice this principle in your life, worshiping the Lord through the giving of your finances, God, you can't outgive God. God will supply all your needs according to His glorious riches in Christ Jesus. And actually what it does is it enables the local church to do what it is called to do. And so there's so many great things about the tithe that I love. Tithes and offerings, generosity in the life of the Christian. So let me pray for that. We're going to take that up at the end of the service. You can just drop that in the bucket at the end if you've got a debit card slip or in an envelope that you want to put in. Father, I just thank you so much for your blessing on our financial lives. I pray for your people sitting here, sitting at home. Father, I just thank you for, Lord, to bless your people as we're faithful with what you've given us. Lord, I know that you can trust us to be faithful with more. We want to be conduits for the kingdom. We want to be conduits to see blessing released financially into the kingdom, Father, to see your gospel spread throughout the earth in Jesus' name. So we thank you for that great privilege and we thank you for the beautiful act of worshiping you through giving in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Awesome. Well, just in a moment, we're going to continue to worship with the team. Later, Pastor Zach's going to get up. But why don't we all stand together right now? Kids, you can head out to DBK. Have a fantastic time. Enjoy yourselves. Brilliant. Thank you, parents. Awesome to see kids in the house of God. Just as the kids are moving out, could we just, as we're about to head back into worship, could we take a moment to pray for our world? You know, there's so many things happening around the world. You know, wars, floods. Jesus told us all this stuff would happen. But we just want to just pray God's protection right now. Amen. Father, we just lift up the state of our world right now. I want to lift up to you the crises and situations known and unknown to us here today. You're in charge. I just pray for peace over in Europe in Jesus' name. I just pray for cooler heads to prevail. I just pray against the enemy forces that we don't fight against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. I pray against those enemy forces that are trying to incite war and violence. Be still in Jesus' name. We pray for peace, the Prince of Peace, to reign over that area. Father, we just pray for protection for our countrymen over in New South Wales, Brisbane, Father, as they've experienced severe weather, Lord, and flooding. God, I just thank you for people banding together, rising up to help there. But we just pray for the flood waters to subside. And again, like peace, be still to the storms in Jesus' name. Lord, we just pray for peace around our world, for our brothers and sisters around the nations that are getting persecuted. Lord, we just pray that you would be strengthening them, be with them, help them. And we just thank you right now, Lord, as we begin to worship you right now. I just declare, Lord, that it is a sound of warfare in the heavenlies. Father, that as we begin to lift up the name of Jesus, we lift it up over this nation, over the nations of the world. We declare in the heavenlies that Jesus is King right now, to all the glory of God the Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
'Cause your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Oh, we sing your name, 'cause your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Oh no, your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Oh, we sing the name. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, come on, sing that again. And oh, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble.
Jesus, Jesus,
you silence fear. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus,
Jesus,
come on, we sing your name.
'Cause your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome.
No, we can't.
'Cause your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome.
Come on, church, do we believe that this morning? We sing.
'Cause your name is alive that the shadows can't deny. Your name be overcome.
No, we can, no, we can.
Your name is alive, you're forever lifted high. Your name, oh, cannot be overcome.
So we sing, Jesus,
oh, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus,
what a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name. fall before you. You silence the boast of sin and greed. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. Before you are raised.
Come on, church. Do you believe it this morning? Come on, we sing. You have no rival.
Cause you have no rival. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above.
Come on, church, we sing. You have no rival.
Cause you have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the
now. We just want to be servants of the Word of God. Father, we just praise that we're about to hear the Word of God. I pray that it would spark obedience in us. It would change and renew our mind. Father, that your grace would fall upon us. And Father, we just thank you that your Word is like a hammer. Father, your Word is powerful. It's like a two-edged sword. And thank you, Lord, it divides between soul and spirit, and it judges our thoughts and attitudes deep within us. And I thank you for that in Jesus' name. So Lord, we just praise you right now, and we thank you for the privilege of serving and worshiping you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, everybody, why don't we take a moment to honor Pastor Zach as he comes and brings the word to us this morning. Thanks, team.
Good morning, everybody. You can take your seat. Thank you. Hey, can we give it up for the worship team? How good this morning. Mel, I loved that start. Like, I love the realness. It's so good. Hey, it's an honor to be here today. If we haven't met, my name's Zach. I have been here before, believe it or not, but it was many years ago. It was for a creative team night. Is anyone here that was at that night? Nope, brand new, fantastic. Oh, Jess was here. This is my friend Jess McPhail, everybody, from the Valley, visiting today. Fantastic. Hey, can we, I just wanted to honor Pastor Tim and Mel and just thank you for the honor of speaking here today and being with you. Restrictions or not, any time to bring the Word of God, it's just such an honor. And you guys just, you know what I love about you? You are so authentic. You love people and you are real with people. You're building an amazing church that is missionally focused. And I'm just so grateful for you. Everyone at Alpha raves about you. Can we just give it up for Tim and Mel, just amazing pastors of yours. So as I said, my name's Zach and I'm married. I have a beautiful wife, Claire. She was a pastor with me on staff at Riverview Church, which is my home church. And I have two young boys, Judah and Felix. Judah is 7 years old. Felix is 5 years old. So you know that I'm tired all the time. I've got two young boys playing sport, loving sport, running around. It's fantastic. I just love the season of life that we're in at the moment. And so my context really and how I came to be here today is that I was on staff at Riverview Church for 14 years on staff. So came to the church And like most people in ministry, didn't plan to be in ministry, didn't have a dream to be in ministry, God just kind of called me into it. So I started serving in our youth ministry, then became our worship pastor, creative pastor, and then most recently in the last 3 years have been executive pastor for the church. And at Riverview, I'm not sure if you're aware, but it's been through quite a big transition period. There's an amazing guy, Steve McCready, Pastor Steve, who's leading the church now. And I felt God was calling me out into a new season of blessing the church. You know, I felt like he was taking me out of one church to bless hundreds of churches. And God opened a door to join Alpha Australia, which I know you guys are massive fans of, huge supporters of. Alpha are just doing a phenomenal job. And I spoke with Melinda Dwight, who leads Alpha. And Melinda invited me to be part of the team. And so I've been part of the team 4 months now. I was just this week in Melbourne. And I am happy to report there is civilization beyond Western Australia. And, you know, they don't have masks anymore. So if anything, it's just an encouragement that the end will come. We'll be okay. We will get through this. And people in Melbourne send their regards to the biggest luxury prison in Australia called WA. Actually, kind of sad. I'm sure some of you have experienced this, but I sat next to a lady on the plane and we had a long conversation about how she hasn't seen her grandkids in 2.5 years. And so she, when we landed, was understandably crying. And we were able to talk just about the joy of coming back. So Australia is coming back together. Praise God. How good. Hey, well, there's lots of great things happening. And today, I just want to share a little bit of my heart. I want to bring a word that's on my heart to you. And I pray that it lands on good soil this morning, that you receive what I believe God wants to say to us. But first, I just want to talk a little bit about Alpha. I know you're huge fans and huge supporters of Alpha. And so I'd planned to play a video, but I don't want to play that anymore because I think you guys totally get what it's about. You get the heart of it. I just really sense that this morning. But I do want to just declare, I guess, that we are in the greatest season of evangelism in our lifetime. We are in an amazing season, an incredible open door that God has created within the context of Australia. Australians are more open to the gospel than they've ever been. During the pandemic, listen to this, this is McCrindle statistics. A third of Australians during the pandemic thought more about God. Wow. 28% of Australians said they prayed more in the pandemic. Nearly 50% of Australians have thought more in the pandemic about the meaning of life and 47% their mortality or the fact that they have a fragile life. Listen to this in 2021. This is McCrindle statistics from last year. Two-thirds of Australians would consider attending a church service if they were personally invited by a friend or family member. Two-thirds. One-third of Australians said they definitely would attend if they were invited by a friend or family member. Isn't that phenomenal? I feel like sometimes we get in our mind like it's like 1 in 10 would come. But the statistics are saying it's actually just an incredible open season. We're in the greatest season of evangelism. And I believe that, you know, Alpha is just a great tool to enable that ministry to happen in our world. Let me tell you a couple of really cool stories. So, just recently, I was down in Albany with a church down there, and COVID, like many churches, absolutely smashed their church. And this is a beautiful Anglican church in Albany, and they previously had a Sunday night service, but they didn't have enough people to attend anymore, so they closed that service. But in the last few months, what they've decided to do is they started running a Sunday evening Alpha, right? And so they started doing Alpha, they invited all their friends, and I want to just encourage you that there was 50 people that attended that Alpha, and I think about 30 of them gave their life to Jesus in that church, and that church is still flourishing and functioning. And the pastor told me a couple of weeks back that their Sunday night service, they're still running it exactly like Alpha, and it's just an evangelistically focused service, and they got people from the community coming in and coming to faith every week. Isn't that amazing? It's phenomenal. It's awesome. And last week I spoke to a pastor who said, yeah, we ran an Alpha, I think this was in Rockingham, and they had 4 Mormons on the Alpha. 2 of the Mormons have decided to follow Jesus, and they're working on the other 2. Isn't that amazing? Let me tell you about a girl called Susan. Susan rocked up to church recently, and she had all these questions about life. She's from the Baha'i faith. And so what she was struggling with was there was a whole bunch of questions she had in her life that her faith couldn't answer. And so she came to church to understand, what is this Christian claim that their God is the true God? And so she came in, and the pastors recognized, wow, she's got a lot of questions. Got questions, try Alpha. So they put her into an Alpha, and after 8 weeks, she gave her life to Jesus. And here's the cool thing. Just 2 weeks ago, she was baptized in that church and is flourishing, serving God, loving God. But here's the cool thing. All of her family, people from the Baha'i faith, came along to the church for her baptism and now are interested in the things of God. Isn't that amazing? Like, God is doing so much as we gather, not just in the temple, but around tables, in homes, in small places. God is working in our nation. And I want to just declare that the harvest is here. You know, so often we spend time, God, praying for the harvest. But didn't Jesus talk about that? That the harvest is plentiful, but it's the workers that are few. And so we need workers. We need people to say, yes, I'm going to serve God in that way. I'm going to gather people around a table. I'm going to preach the gospel. And so I'm so excited to hear that you guys have a vision to equip and enable Alphas to run all across the length and breadth of the Swan Valley, in your context, in your workplace, in your school, in your soccer club, in your mum's group, whatever it is. That is fantastic. And I want to encourage you that it's absolutely achievable. It's absolutely doable. And the truth is, to unlock that reality is to understand that where God has placed me now is my mission field. You know, so often in life, and I testify for myself, so often I'm like, I'm going to do that when I get to this point. But how many of you know when you get to that point, then you're going to say, and then the next point, come on, the season is now. The season to sow is now. The season to plant is now. It's not next year, it's this year. You know, I feel like the enemy's just having a field day with these masks. It's like Satan and all of his little minions up in heaven. They're like, what shall we do to discourage the church and break them up? I know, let's give them masks. What a ridiculous strategy. Come on, we're not going to allow masks. We're not going to allow restrictions to stop us sowing the gospel of Jesus. Amen? We're a people on mission. And Jesus' vision for the church is that we wouldn't just endure life or enjoy life here, but we would sow seeds of the kingdom in and across our life. He wants seeds of the kingdom of God sowed into every nook and cranny, into every workplace, every school, every footy club, every relationship, every social group. It's not just that we would enjoy the kingdom, but we would reproduce kingdom life wherever we go. Amen? Jesus said this in Matthew's gospel, chapter 13. He said, the kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed planted in a field. It's the smallest of all seeds, but it becomes the largest of garden plants. It grows into a tree, and the birds come and make their nests in its branches. What a beautiful passage and a reminder that the kingdom of heaven is a seed that is planted. And who plants this seed? Yes, God plants this seed. But I believe the Bible says in chapter 13, earlier in the first verse, that God supplies seed to the sower. God gives seed in our hand to plant. So the kingdom of God that becomes like a tree must be planted into the lives of people around us. So I just want to spend some time today. This is my message, these two verses. I want to unpack these with you. I want to talk out of the Word of God, because like Pastor Tim said, the Word of God is a double-edged sword. Not my thoughts, not my opinions. I want to just expound this scripture, these two verses, and speak into that. And whenever I read scripture, I like to ask why. Why is this here? Why was this said? What's the context behind it? What is Jesus actually getting at in saying that? And how can we apply this to our lives? The why, the what, and the how. So I'm going to spend about 5 minutes talking about the why, and then we're going to spend the majority of our time talking about how this can apply to our lives. Does it sound all right? Great. Well, I'm going to do it anyway, even if it doesn't sound all right. Let's pray before we start. Father, we just come before you in prayer right now. And we ask that as I speak this word, that it would land on great soil. Open hearts, I pray, God. I pray that it would reproduce kingdom life in our own lives and in the lives of our communities. In Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Awesome. Hey, so let's talk about, why did Jesus say the kingdom is like a seed that becomes a tree? Why did he say? Well, Jesus was a master storyteller. We know that. And so Jesus talked in parables, in riddles, in metaphors, in analogies about what the kingdom was like. He was trying to reveal to his disciples what the kingdom was like and the people around him. So the fact that Jesus said the kingdom's like a mustard seed that becomes a tree isn't exactly mind-blowing. I mean, it's just a picture, a prophetic picture, a prophetic metaphor of what God was doing in the world. And Jesus was declaring that this seed would become big, that it would grow. And it followed a whole bunch of other stories. Jesus, in this same passage, talked about the farmer scattering seed, the parable of the wheat and the weeds, the parable of the yeast that works through the whole dough, the parable of the treasure and the pearl, the parable of the fishing net. So Jesus told a lot of stories that related to the seed becoming tree. But what's important in this parable, and I think the thing that unlocks the truth in it, is who Jesus was talking to. Whenever you read the scriptures, always ask, who is he talking to? Because the person or the people that he's talking to unlock what Jesus is trying to get at and what he's trying to say. So Jesus was talking to Jewish people. Well, why does this matter? Well, two things. Firstly, Jewish people believed that the kingdom of heaven was a place after they died. Believed that the kingdom of heaven was a place that they went after death. Life eternal. And perhaps that's some of our understanding as well. Well, Jesus was claiming, no, the kingdom of God is a seed planted now. Jesus is saying the kingdom is here and now. He's using the seed because it implies that it's small. It implies that it's buried. It implies that it's not yet fully fulfilled. Theologians call this the now but not yet paradox. I wonder, you know, was the kingdom planted in that moment that Jesus said it? Or was Jesus maybe foreshadowing his death and his resurrection like a seed buried beneath the ground, but one day to rise through the ground, through the rubble, into new life? Amen? Secondly, Jesus is getting at, what does this tell us? It tells us that Jesus is correcting the Jewish people who believed that they were God's chosen people. So what this parable tells us is Jesus is correcting the understanding, no, that it's just for us. Jesus is in fact saying the kingdom is for everyone. The Bible says, and Jesus says in this passage, in these two verses, that this tree would become a huge tree where birds of the air from all tribes and nations would flock to sit on its branches. So Jesus was challenging and reframing who the kingdom of heaven was for. It wasn't just for the Jewish elite. It wasn't just for the super Christians. But the kingdom of heaven is available to everyone. Where the seed is planted in the life of a person, there the kingdom is. The kingdom is not just for a select few, but the kingdom is for all. And, you know, so this is rich in just a little bit of theology. I mean, Daniel and Ezekiel talk about great kingdoms that are represented as trees. And so there is great rich theology that Jesus is drawing on in reframing this. Jesus, in essence, is saying in this passage, the kingdom, God's rule and reign, is come. It has come. It is planted, and it's here now. And Jesus is saying the kingdom, God's rule and reign, is available to anyone and everyone. All right, so that's our why. That's what Jesus is trying to say. So how does this apply to our life? What are we meant to do with this? It's the kingdom is for now and its kingdom is for everyone. How are we meant to sow seeds? How are we meant to activate this reality of kingdom life, being sowers of the word of God? Well, I want to give you five lessons from this parable. I'm calling this message Lessons from a Mustard Seed. They might be small lessons, but I pray that as they're shared this morning, that they become like a tree in your life and they become seeds that you can sow into the lives of others. Amen. So the first lesson from the mustard seed is this: the kingdom is present. The kingdom is present. You know, most believers I've found in my life of being a pastor, most believers actually still believe that the kingdom of heaven is only something that we go to after we die. Well, I want to encourage you that actually eternal life, the promise of eternal life, is both now and future. You can actually receive eternal life, the Bible says, now. Listen to it in John 17, verse 3, in the Message paraphrase. It says, "And this is the real and eternal life, that they know you, the one and only true God, and Christ Jesus, whom you sent. So we aren't waiting for eternity. Eternity starts here and now. Come on, we pray about it. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. These aren't just words that we pray. This is the reality of heaven, that heaven is breaking in through the earth now. And so Jesus is saying in this parable, the kingdom is present. It's not going to be planted. It has been planted. It will be planted. It is planted. Yes, the kingdom is not yet complete. We know that. I mean, we don't have to look very far, like Tim was praying about today. We don't have to look far across the world to see the brokenness of humanity and the reality that we still need Jesus to return. But the kingdom is here now, and Jesus is encouraging us to be present as the kingdom is present. I want to give you three evidences that the kingdom is present. Firstly, the miracle of salvation and sanctification. This speaks to the seed of the kingdom planted in your own life. The reality that we are transformed people is an absolute evidence that the kingdom of heaven is present. Otherwise, we would just live in our suffering without a Savior until we die and then somehow meet Him. No. The fact that we have received eternal life, the fact that we have confessed with our mouth and believed in our heart is a sign that the kingdom life is present here and now. The kingdom, you know, shouldn't stay a seed in the life of a believer, amen. The kingdom should develop and flourish and be nurtured and matured to full fruition, that we should become like trees in the kingdom of God that bring shade and protection to the people around us. That is an evidence of a present kingdom. The second evidence of a present kingdom is the ministry of the gospel. What a wonderful thing that Jesus didn't just come for us, but He came for all people. And so the fact that we can minister the gospel, that we can declare the name of Jesus, as we sung before, that no darkness would flee from the name of Jesus, that where Jesus is present, there is power and authority in the world. The fact that we can go and make disciples, that we can heal the sick, that we can look after the poor, is a sign of kingdom life present here and now. And the last evidence of the kingdom is the work of the Spirit. The reality is we are in the age of the Holy Spirit. Jesus left and He said, I will give you someone even greater than me, the Holy Spirit. You know, there's nothing that can be accomplished on the earth apart from the person, the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so the fact that the Holy Spirit is present and working in the world is an evidence that we are in a present kingdom. And you know, I believe the Holy Spirit is powerfully moving across the earth, healing. He gives the ability to the believer for a divine empowerment to see miracles happen. Let me tell you about a story in our church. In the life of our church, the other executive on our team, Tanya Watson, you may know her or have heard of her. Her husband, Neil, was actually diagnosed with a terminal brain tumor. And this is a huge thing in the life of our church. And Neil was an avid cyclist, and he physically couldn't even do that anymore. He struggled to walk. He had to have a frame in order to walk. And the doctors, the tumor on his brain was about that big. And they had given him like weeks to live. And so Neil had quit his job that he'd been in for many, many years and was now in palliative care. And Neil and Tanya, just their great faith and their surrender to God, had decided, well, if this is God's will, then we submit to it. And so they just submitted to the will of God and trusted God and obviously prayed for a different outcome, but didn't want to be kind of, you know, the big focus in the moment. But I tell you, you can take the boy out of a Pentecostal church, but you can't take the Pentecostal out of a boy. I was shaka-ka-ka-ka. I mean, we were just declaring in faith. We were believing for a miracle. The church was united together. And I want to tell you just the most fabulous report that Neil went to the doctor, and they did another brain scan, and the surgeons, the doctors, the radiographers could not understand. The tumor was absolutely gone. Completely gone. Like, unbelievable. All of us were shocked, but of course we know the supernatural working God is present in this world and He works miracles. I don't know why it doesn't happen for everyone, but this is certainly an incredible miracle that is nothing short of miraculous. And so the kingdom of God is present. The kingdom of God is here. God is working. God is moving in our world. Listen to it. 1 Corinthians 4:20. The kingdom of God is not just a lot of talk. It is living by God's power. So if the kingdom is present, are you present? If the kingdom is present in this world and we're living by God's power, where are you living by God's power? Where is God asking you to sow seeds of the kingdom? Where are you present in your world? What are you doing with what God's put in your hand? He supplies seed to the sower. So where are we sowing seeds? Where are we being present in the lives of those around us? Do the people at your workplace know you're a believer? Come on, maybe it's time to be present and to start sowing seeds of the gospel. Amen? So the first lesson of the mustard seed is the kingdom is present. The second lesson is the kingdom is perplexing. Perplexing, that's an interesting word. The dictionary defines perplexing as to make someone feel completely baffled. I love that. Don't you reckon sometimes the kingdom of God is baffling? It seems like upside down, right? I mean, the kingdom of heaven is present, but so often it's hard to see. It's like a seed buried in the ground. The sower knows that it's been planted, but to everyone else, it just looks like dirt and rubble. To everyone else, it looks just like fallow ground. So don't be surprised when people around you, in you being present, don't believe your claim about Jesus. Because to others, often the kingdom is perplexing. And God comes in surprising ways. I mean, this is what was happening as Jesus was sharing this parable out of his very mouth. This is exactly what was happening in the atmosphere. People expected that Jesus was the Messiah that would ride in on a white horse with a big sword and slay all of the bad guys. He was there to conquer and to release us from our trouble. But listen, the kingdom is not a transplanted tree. It is a seed. The kingdom is not a tree, it's a seed that grows into a tree. And so often the kingdom looks a bit baffling. I honestly don't believe that God is baffling. I think it's our expectations of God based on the world's culture that it baffles us. So for example, the world says, save yourself. Jesus says, I'm here to save the world. The world says you got to love yourself first. Jesus says love me and love others first. The world says my needs come first. I'm here to look after me. Jesus says seek first my kingdom and all of these things will be added. The world says get more influence. Jesus says use your influence. Give it away to serve others. The world says blessed are the powerful. Jesus says blessed are the meek. I mean, it's quite a contrast, and I think sometimes we build expectations of God based on the culture that we're surrounded by. And so this parable is an invitation to shake up our expectations and reset our faith on God who is planted, God who is powerful, God who is more fruitful than anything this world could offer. Amen? See, there's this testing that comes with the seed. As it baffles you, there is also a breaking of our character. There's a testing that happens as the seed is planted into the ground. Listen, the seed has to leave your hand in order for it to go into the ground. So there's a surrender and a releasing. You know, I moved to Perth when I was 15 years old. I didn't grow up here. I grew up in Newcastle, New South Wales. Love New South Wales. Woo! Yeah. But I've been here more than half my life now. I married a WA girl, so I'm a West Australian at heart. But I moved here, and we didn't know anybody here. We felt called by God to move here. Sounds like a really big thing, and it was a big thing. I mean, I was involved in church back home in Newcastle, and God was opening some amazing doors for me. I was a musician. I played guitar, and that's how I came to be a worship pastor. And at the time, I was involved with like New South Wales Youth Alive, and the guys at Planet Shakers were asking me to go on tour to Malaysia. It was like God was opening my life up. And as soon as we decided to move, on the word of God, all of those doors closed. And I came here to Perth, Western Australia, and I'd played on stages in front of thousands of people, and I wasn't even allowed on the stage at Riverview. You know, it was years before I got on the stage, and I think I played acoustic guitar in the corner just faithfully. See, the world says be successful. Jesus says be sacrificial. And what Jesus was teaching me in that time, he was testing my character to say, will you serve me even in the unseen places? And I got to tell you, I would not be on this platform today if it wasn't for the faith of my parents to move to Western Australia. I would not be doing what I'm doing, nor have the opportunities I've had in ministry if we didn't move. But I couldn't see that at the time. So listen, the kingdom is perplexing. It often looks unexpected and it requires sacrifice. But God is at work in that sacrificial place. So where in your life are you expecting God to give you a tree instead of a seed? Where in your life are you expecting God to make and transplant a tree that's already finished when he's given you a seed and he's asking you to plant it? Come on, we've got to trust the word and the purposes of God, amen? To know that his ways are higher, that his thoughts are beyond ours, that he sees much further. You know, nothing that's happening in the world right now takes God by surprise, and that is great comfort to me. Listen to what the wisdom writer writes in Proverbs 19:21. Many are the plans in a person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. Can you say amen? Amen. Third lesson of the mustard seed is the kingdom is patient. The kingdom is patient. You know, God is not in a rush, but we often are. I think patience apparently is a fruit of the Spirit, and it's the one that God's still working on in me. I mean, I am just the most impatient person, and I've come to realize that nothing in all of creation rushes apart from humans. I mean, a tree doesn't rush. The birds of the air don't rush. The animals in the sea or on the land don't rush. But humans seem to constantly be in a rush. We're so impatient, particularly in this culture of instant gratification. You know, so there are so many leaders that have preached and talked about the fact that the kingdom is patient. You know, just to name one particular one, John Mark Comer. I'm not sure who's heard of John Mark Comer. Give me a wave. Not many. He wrote a fantastic book called The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry. And I'd encourage you to get hold of that book. It talks about the busyness of our life and the pace of our life is unsustainable and actually incongruent with the kingdom of heaven. And so he teaches some principles about how to slow down and how to live a more sustainable pace of life. But look, I'm not going to speak into that because I feel like so many guys and so many women and so many leaders have spoken into that space. I just want to give you two thoughts about the kingdom being patient. Firstly, patience requires seasons of obscurity. Patience requires seasons of hiddenness. You know, the seed in the ground can feel like a season of obscurity. And it's a test, like I was saying, with my story of coming to Perth. Required a season of obscurity. Will I serve God, trust God, even when it feels like he's not working? Will I love God? Will the lips of my life glorify God, even when it doesn't feel like it? You know, maybe some of you here right now in a season of obscurity, you are believing God for something, but that thing feels like it's hidden. It still feels like it's a dream that God's given you in your heart. Well, I feel like the Lord just wants to tell you today that the giver of the dream is the safekeeper of the dream. The giver of the dream is the safekeeper of the dream. Trust him that in his timing, it will become reality. Be patient in the kingdom. Second lesson of patience is that patience requires faithfulness. The Bible says, don't get weary in doing good, and you will receive a harvest at the appointed time, at the right time. The problem is we often don't know the timing, right? And so we force and we push and we rush. But the truth is, fruitfulness comes from faithfulness. It's only when we stay connected to the vine that the vine produces fruit. I mean, you're in the valley, the Swan Valley. If there's any metaphor that makes this come true, it's the grapes that are attached to the vine. The only way for fruit, for life to come, is to stay attached to the vine. And so often in my life, I'm quick to try and rush ahead of God, to force the timing into my own hands, but sometimes we've just got to learn to be faithful. You know, oak trees, beautiful big oak trees, don't actually start producing acorns until they're 20 years old. 20 years old before there's any fruit. You know, sometimes we've got to understand that it takes time to mature. Sometimes we've got to understand that the kingdom takes time to mature in our lives. You know, an oak tree, actually, they start producing at 20 years old, but peak production for an oak tree of acorns that can be planted into the ground is ages 50 to 80. Wow, isn't that amazing? What a beautiful metaphor for life, the reality that God is working constantly in our life, and fruitfulness only comes by staying faithful to the Lord in all seasons. May we be people of faithfulness. As Eugene Peterson once wrote, like a life of following Jesus is a long obedience in the same direction. I love that. How good is that? You know, the truth is life with Jesus is not a moment, it's a lifetime, right? It takes time to develop. It takes time to mature. It takes time to sow potent, faithful seeds in the kingdom of God. Point number four, the kingdom is full of potential. So the kingdom isn't just present, it's not just perplexing, or it's not just patient, it's full of potential. I wonder if you've ever thought the reality of the seed becoming a tree. I think I've got a picture of a tree, a mustard tree. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? I hope it's a mustard tree. I don't know. I searched mustard tree and that's what came up. So we'll go with it. But what an amazing comparison. Like in the mustard seed is the smallest of all seeds. I can't even make with my hand the smallness of what it is. But that potency becomes that. What an incredible reality. And the word of God in this to us is that the kingdom is full of potential. As we sow into the lives of others, we have no idea what it may produce in years to come. My life as a minister, as a pastor, you know, sometimes I've sowed seeds that I've never even realized and only 10 years later have seen the fruit of. God is a God of potential. And so I want to just tell you today two things I think this helps us see. God wants us to see the potential in others when he looks at people. Firstly, God sees the potential in you. You may be surrounded by dirt right now. You may be in a season of loneliness. You may feel like people don't understand you. You may feel like you're alone, but God sees. He sees the potential in your life. He sees the seed. And I tell you, he's more excited about what the future looks like than even you are. God sees the potential in you. You know, remember, big things grow from small things sown in faith. Big things grow from small things that are sown in faith. So what is God sowing in your life right now? What is he asking you to nurture and to mature? What is he sowing in your heart? Things of the kingdom. Maybe it's the fruit of the Spirit like we talked about earlier. Maybe it's patience. Maybe it's God is sowing things in your life. He sees the potential of who you're becoming, not just who you are right now. He loves you and he sees just great things for your future. But I think God also calls us in this to see the potential in other people. To call it out of other people, to love other people as God sees them, to see them as he sees them. You know, I've seen too many relationships break up and people walk away from the church all because they made assumptions about what's happening beneath the surface. All because they made conclusions about what's happening of the seed inside the ground. But listen, that's why I always tell people, if you didn't see it with your own eyes, if you didn't hear it with your own ears, don't speak it with your own mouth, right? Come on, we've got to refuse to buy into gossip and assumption about what's happening in the church or what's happening in the life of our leaders or what's happening in relationships. Come on, we've got to believe the best about people. We've got to speak life over people because sometimes we're the only people in their life that will. I want to tell you, there's a lot of fault finders in this world. There's a lot of people that will pick at all of the issues in your life. But can we be people of God that are gold miners? We find the gold inside people and we call it out of them. We believe you can do it. I believe in you. You're amazing. God is on your life. Can we be people that speak the best over people? Amen? Amen. Come on, your influence is enormous. Think about the people that you interface with in life, in your workplace, in your school, in your university, in your community, your neighbors. You have so much influence. Can we be people that speak life over others? In the tongue, there is the power of death and life. May we be people that see the potential in the life of other people. You know, no seed is too small. No seed is too buried. No seed is too deep or too dead for the touch of God to bring it to life. Amen. The kingdom is full of potential. And lastly, Mel, you can come up and play behind me as we land this plane. The kingdom is to be planted. The kingdom is to be planted. A seed isn't much use if it's never planted. The seed itself doesn't nourish. The seed doesn't feed a family. The seed doesn't satisfy. The seed is given to be planted. Seed is given to the sower, says the scriptures. So a seed that's unplanted remains a seed. but it's supplied to the sower to plant. So let me tell you a story about my mate Bernie. You know, Bernie's here today. I've got a picture of him and I sitting at a cafe. I put that picture up before I knew you were coming. So now you're here, it's kind of, we've got double Bernie. Bernie had a successful career as an engineer and was ready to retire and relaxed into, you know, his well-earned retirement. But Bernie felt a prompting of God to start Alpha in the prison. I mean, we were talking about it, and it's like Bernie never planned to go to prison nor wanted to go to prison. It's like, why the prison, Lord? But regardless, that's what God spoke to him. There was an invitation and an open door for that, and Bernie just said yes. It's like, yes, Lord, I'll do that. And, you know, we sat there a few weeks ago now at the cafe just with tears in our eyes, talking about all that God had done from that yes. As I know, like, Dream Builders are a part of Bernie's ministry alongside Lakeside at Acacia. And Bernie just recently is on his 21st Alpha in Acacia Prison. Isn't that amazing? 340 men have done Alpha in the prison, and many of them given their life to Jesus and been changed and transformed forever. What an amazing story. What an amazing man of faithfulness. What an amazing man that is patient, that's present. Just sums up really all that I've been talking about today, that the kingdom is planted, that becomes a tree for others to perch upon. But the truth is, it would have stayed a seed unless Bernie said yes. We have lots of visions and lots of ideas, but until we actually start sowing, nothing becomes the tree that God designed or intended. What started as a small seed has become a thriving tree. And we're just praying at the moment about God opening the door for 10 more prisons in WA. And yes, we're facing a little bit of setback right now with COVID, but it's not a shutdown, it's just a setback. And we're believing that God will continue to open doors. We've been able to have a breakthrough recently with another church coming on board with another prison that we're at, which is just phenomenal. And God's doing amazing things in this. But it only came because someone was willing to plant. And God, I believe, is looking for the someones. He's looking for someone that will say yes. What will you do with what's in your hand? What is God asking you to sow? Maybe think about it in your own life today. Maybe it's a business. Maybe it's a new ministry in the church. Maybe it's just sowing into your marriage and into your family again. Maybe we haven't been talking about the things of God, and maybe it's time to bring it back to the dinner table. Maybe it's sowing into your friendships. Maybe it's just sending a scripture to a friend who's going through a hard time. Maybe it's offering to pray for someone. You know, I'm a chaplain at a local footy club, and you know, 98% of the guys in that footy club don't know Jesus, and I offer to pray for them all the time. Maybe it's just praying with someone. Maybe it's inviting someone to Alpha. Maybe it's inviting someone to church. Come on, where is God asking you to plant the seed in your hand? It's in your hand. You know, often I think the reason that we don't plant, and for my own life, why I don't sow seeds often, is because I'm so focused on the outcome. It's like I calculate the risk. Like, can I possibly see this person coming to God? And so I'll only sow. It's almost like I'm looking for a little green shoot, but God's asking me to sow a seed without that, to trust Him, to have faith in Him. You know, so often I'm focused on the outcome, and I'm trying to probably control the outcome, and so I don't sow. But God calls us sowers, not growers. Our job is not to grow the tree. Our job is to sow the seed. So stop worrying about the outcome and start being obedient with what that which God has put in your hand. Stop worrying about the outcome of whether someone's life will get fixed up and turned around. You know, you can't fix, you can't solve their sin. You can't heal them of their brokenness. Only the Holy Spirit can do that. Your job is invitation. God's job is transformation. Your job is to invite, to sow. You know, often, so often in my life, the reason I stopped sowing in the lives of people is because I become discouraged because they rejected me. But how many times was Jesus rejected? Come on. time to build some resilience in our life of planting seeds. You know, Melinda, our leader of Alpha in Australia, she talks often about this idea of the clock face of faith. If you imagine invitation of people to the gospel, imagine it like a clock face with 12 all the way through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way around. And our research tells us that people will not accept an invitation of faith on the first time. And often it takes 12 times before they'll accept the call of the gospel. And I've got to be honest, sometimes I just give up at probably like 4 or 5. I start to become discouraged. But the word of God to you today is don't be discouraged. Come on, it's time to sow. In our nation, it is time to sow. The season for sowing is now. And every time you invite, you're moving people slowly around the clock face of faith. So don't be discouraged, believer, when you invite someone to Alpha or you invite someone to church and they say no. Just stay firm, keep encouraging, keep sowing. The tree will never grow if the seed is never planted. So where is God asking you to sow? So the kingdom is present, it's perplexing, it's patient, it's full of potential, but it must be planted. Can you say amen? Amen. Hey, would you stand to your feet this morning? I just want to pray for you as a community before Pastor Tim comes up and closes the service. I feel to pray just a commissioning over you as you pursue this vision to see Alphas planted in every part of the city through your life, to take a step of faith, to launch an Alpha. I pray that you will. I pray that you'll plant the seed that God has put in your hand. But I want to just encourage you and pray this morning that as you plant the seeds of faith into the life of people, you must understand and catch the revelation that in order for anything to grow, it's not the soil to be right. It's not the environment to be perfect. It is only water that will grow seeds. Listen, without water, nothing is possible, and we need the water of God to fall on the seeds that we're planting into the lives of others. We need a fresh outpouring and anointing of the Holy Spirit on the ministry of our hands and the ministry of our feet. Without the Holy Spirit, nothing is possible. Amen? So right now, come on, would you lift your hands towards heaven? And I want to pray for an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. If you're saying yes, God, if you're entering into this moment asking for a fresh touch of the Holy Spirit, come on, lift your hands towards heaven. God, I just pray right now, would you fall like rain on the lives of every heart? Would you nourish the seed in our own hearts first? God, would you bring the seed to full maturity? Would you bring it to full fruition in the name of Jesus? Lord, I pray against the work of the enemy this morning that would seek to rob and kill and destroy every life of the seeds that have been stolen. Jesus, we declare your life over them. Father, I pray right now for a rushing wind of the Spirit to blow upon this place, to blow upon every heart. Father, may you direct our hands to sow seeds into the right positions, into the right places. Would you direct our hand to the right people? Would you introduce us this week, we pray, for divine appointments, Lord. And Lord, I pray just for a rain of the Spirit to fall over the Swan Valley. May this area be one for the glory of your name, Jesus. Holy Spirit, empower us. We can't do this without you. Without you, they're just seeds in the ground. And so we, God, we pray for transformation in the name of Jesus. We pray for new life in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray right now for new dreams, new visions to be birthed in this moment as we wait on you, Holy Spirit. New ideas, new ministries, new businesses. Come, Holy Spirit, come and breathe life into those places. For those that are in this patient, obscure season, Lord, I pray blessing over them this morning. I pray that the water of the Spirit would renew and refresh in Jesus' name. All to the glory and honor of your name, Jesus, we pray. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Everybody said this morning, amen. God bless you, dream builders. Love it.
Awesome. And if we could just be praying for Zach and his family, just in their new role in that ministry. We so appreciate Alpha. We really do, mate. And just the ministry. Big thanks to Melinda and the resource that Alpha pours into the local church. It actually is quite astounding. And I just see a lot of ministries talk about things, but Alpha walks out what they talk. So it's just an amazing, amazing evangelistic organization. We're very, very thankful for that. in the nation and in the nations. I do know that. So very, very thankful. Can we give Pastor Zach another hand just for being here this morning? Thank you so much. You can take your seats just for one moment. I did say before it is Mission Sunday, and so I'm going to just remove this. It is Mission Sunday, and so as part of that, we just do like to focus in. As Pastor Zach said, I want to remind everybody that in third term, right now we're encouraging people to actually start to pray and plan about maybe a seed that God would use in their life to start running their own Alpha course. Maybe it's in a school situation. Maybe it's in a neighborhood situation. Maybe it's with your family or something like that. Whatever it is, I believe that God is going to be speaking to people about it. We're also going to be going into Alpha, hopefully in term, Alpha Prison, hopefully in term three or term four, depending on what happens with all the restrictions and everything like that. I'm desperately trying to get into Bandy Up Prison with that. So I'm just so thankful, but I just love that message today about sowing the seed. And so why don't we just let that sort of permeate in our minds? Because actually, missions, and I'm going to talk about our giving in a moment, but it can't just stop with our giving. It's got to actually go into what we're doing too. Amen? God's called us to minister right where we are. But I love what we're doing as a church. Just a few updates, and we're going to watch a video in a moment from Cambodia. But just a few updates there. In Cambodia, Chin Ho has reported that the country has started to open up again, which we're very thankful for. But unemployment is really, really low, really high. So there's lots of people out of work, and there's lots of charities that have not been able to carry on their regular work there. So Chin Ho says it's been a great opportunity through the money that we're sending there to actually go out and make a difference in the community, and it's really shining a light of Jesus. They've just sent out four new church planters or evangelists into the region to plant new churches there. How awesome is that? So we're so excited about that. They've really been struggling there, but obviously God's doing great things. Also an update about Pastor Lian in Myanmar. Many of you would know his daughter was arrested by the army there and accused. She was simply like distributing food to people and preaching the gospel, but they trumped up a fake charge of political terrorism, basically, and they've sentenced her to jail for 3 years. So her family has not been able to see her. They're really applying for international amnesty to really sort of approach her case. But obviously in Myanmar right now, it's a really tough situation. There's gunfire, explosions, people getting killed every day. But the church is still moving forward. So Pastor Leon is obviously concerned about his daughter. But the church is moving forward. They're restarting churches, planting churches. They just baptized 30 people near the Bangladesh border in a new church that they've started there. So God is moving despite the opposition. And so we're going to pray for them this morning. But since the borders have opened, it does mean that Pastor Gary and Steve can head back to Cambodia and start to continue some of the mission work there, which we're very excited about. We do have a video from Aware Cam that we also support, which is Pastor Gary and Kim's vision and seed that they planted long ago, and it's just flourishing. So why don't we turn our eyes to the screen? We're just going to quickly watch that video. Thank you, guys. Oh, the video is not working. I'm really sorry, guys. I apologize about that. We will try and watch that next week. But anyway, I just wanted to give you that update there and let you know that our missions dollars are making a major difference right now. And who knows, like despite the restrictions and things we face here, that actually WA is in a pretty good spot, wouldn't we say? And I'm just so thankful for the way that God is blessing us. And so I'm going to pray for our missions offering right now. Thank you to those who give week in, week out. If you need to put in your slip today, you can do so at the back or at the information desk, wherever you need to give. The hosts will have the buckets there. But let me pray for that. Father, I just thank you so much, Lord, for our missional partners right around the world. Father, we just pray in Jesus' name that we uplift them to you. And we just thank you, Lord, that even despite hardship, we stand with them in prayer. We pray for freedom for Pastor Leanne's daughter in Jesus' name. Lord, we speak those prison doors fly open in the name of Jesus. You've done it before. You can do it again. Lord, we're praying for a release for your people who are in captivity because of the name of Jesus right now. Lord, we just thank you for continued resource into the kingdom of God around the world. We thank you for the privilege of being on this end of the giving, Father, that, Lord, we have resource to be able to give. And so we're thankful for that. And I pray for us also, Father, the seeds that we're sowing into our hearts and minds about running Alpha in our own communities. I thank you. You're speaking to people right now. Father, we're believing for a great harvest of souls. In Jesus' name, we speak that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Great to be part of a missional church today, everybody. Hey, have a fantastic week. Remember to book your tickets for next week. Don't be late in that. Get straight on it. We'll be sending out an email very soon. Have a fantastic week. God bless you, and we'll see you very, very soon. God bless everyone. Thank you so much.
never change, no matter the time. You are good to me. Every day gets sweeter, every day gets better. Every day gets sweeter, every day gets better. Every day gets sweeter, every day gets better. Every day gets sweeter, every day gets better.
In every hour, in every moment, I'll say you. You never change, oh. You never will, no, no. And I see what you have done, I say that you are good. In the morning I say you are good. You have a perfect record. You never fail, you never change. Good to me. Keep on getting better. Keep on getting better. Keep on getting better.
You keep on getting better.
Just when I thought you ran out of things to do, you keep on
getting better. You keep on getting.
Just when I thought you ran out of ways to move, you keep on
getting better.
Oh, morning by morning, new mercies I see. Oh my God, morning by morning, new mercies I see. Oh my God. Keep on getting better.
Keep on getting better.
Keep on getting better.
Keep on getting better. Keep on getting better.
I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you. Does it take a trophy to make you proud? I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Ooh.
Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me out. You would cross an ocean. You've never